We all care about climate change, and some people are skeptical about climate change. As climate scientists, one of our jobs is to figure out how and why the Earth's temperature has changed in the past, such that we can better predict what climate change will look like in the future. Yet there is one mystery about ocean warming in the early 20th century. This figure shows the North Atlantic temperature from the 1910s to the 40s, and you can see a steady increase by around 0.8 degrees Celsius. But if we look at the Pacific, as shown in the blue curve, it only warmed by around 0.3 degrees. Why is there such a big discrepancy in the warming rate? This is concerning, because our physical understanding has predicted that human activities should lead to rather uniform warming, since the greenhouse gases we emit are almost evenly distributed in the atmosphere. So does that mean our physical theory is insufficient? Well, let's hold on for a second. Before revising the theory, I'm actually more concerned about the quality of these historical data, especially after understanding how these early ocean temperatures were collected in the first place. Back in the early 20th century, most ocean temperatures were not collected by dedicated climate scientists, but just regular sailors. So not for studying climate change, but just for helping them to navigate. Nowadays, these measurements have irreplaceable value because they are the only direct measurement of the past ocean state. However, until the 1950s, most of these measurements were collected by dropping buckets into the ocean and measuring water temperature in buckets on ship decks. So during the process of measurement, water temperature can become colder by several tenths of a degree Celsius due to wind evaporation. This was not a big problem back at that time because the accuracy required for navigation from temperature was low. However, if we are to use the same data out of their historical context and study climate change that was only within 1 degree Celsius throughout the entire 20th century, we have to account for bucket bias. Yet, accurately accounting for bucket bias is not easy. Previous studies all assumed that all bucket measurements in the same year are biased in the same way, as if they were measured by the same person using the same bucket. But bucket bias depends on types of buckets being used and measurement protocols being followed. For example, a canvas bucket can be additionally colder than a wooden bucket by more than 0.5 degrees Celsius, even measured under the same condition. Problems may also happen after data collection, as information transferred from the original logbook to punch card, cassette tapes, floppy disks, and all the way to the modern dataset. As a result, in addition to correcting for biases common to all measurements, we may also need to account for unique biases associated with individual groups of the data that can arise from distinct physical and historical reasons. Unfortunately, we do not have enough metadata to make specific yet physically based corrections for every subset. As a result, to solve this problem, I developed a statistical method that quantifies how individual groups differ from one to the other. And my method works like this. It first puts data into more than 150 groups according to their nationality and the purpose of ships. After grouping data, it then pairs measurements coming from different groups when their ships passing nearby, such that the sailors were measuring the same part of the ocean at around the same time, and we will have a chance to tell which group is relatively warmer or colder. This idea is simple, but the data set is actually huge. In total, there are more than 17 million pairs that we need to handle. Things can even get more complicated because measurements in a pair are not always perfectly collocated. For example, measurements that are closer to the equator or taken during the daytime are expected to be warmer. Not to mention that the ocean itself is always varying at a variety of spatial and temporal scales. So after accounting for all these complexities, my method handles all 17 million pairs at the same time and estimate how individual groups differs from one another relative to the average of all of them. After running the statistical analysis, we do find significant differences among groups. And one example is in Japanese measurements. So shown in this figure is the estimated differences for several major data collecting nations in the early 20th century. As you can see, compared with other groups, the Japanese temperature has a sudden drop by around 0.4 degrees Celsius in the 1930s. What has happened? Was it because the Japanese were using a new type of buckets, or something suddenly changed in the post-processing of these measurements? To figure out the reason, I worked like a detective, trying to piece together all available evidence, both physical and historical ones. And I even learned some Japanese to facilitate my document reading. After many trials and errors, I finally came across with a document that says, well, these Japanese measurements were digitized by different people. And when the US Air Force were digitizing data after the 1930s, they truncated the temperature, dropped the decimal, and floored everything to the whole degrees Celsius. Honestly, this was such a horrible data management mistake. But knowing of it really helps us to understand this mystery and the warming rate between the North Atlantic and the Pacific. Because right now, we need to account for this cold truncation bias in Japanese measurements. And Japanese measurements dominated the North Pacific. So after correcting for cold biases in the North Pacific after the 1930s, the new estimates looks like this. Things are becoming much more consistent. And now we know that this discrepancy was nothing physical, but a data problem as simple as a truncation error. And what has happened was much more uniform warming, indicating the dominant role of human activities. My research is a detective story about combining statistical, physical, and historical evidence towards a better depiction of the past climate. It is also a cautionary tale about being skeptical to the quality of the data we see and being knowledgeable to the history of the data we use. Now, we do not only have a better data set, we also have a new statistical framework that can be used to clean up many other data sets that pulls information from heterogeneous sources. And more importantly, we now have a new key towards understanding how and why the climate has changed and how we human beings have played a role. And the more we understand the past, the better we can predict the future. Thank you.